Thank you. And we will go to our webinar programs. Again, I welcome you all to today's program. We have a wonderful topic today's non-invasive ventilation. Nowadays, it is very, everybody is using, became very popular. And today's speaker is the first neonatologist, neonatologist of Twin Cities, and also a United AP, Dr. Surapaneni. Dr. Surapaneni is famous neonatologist and is established first complete neonatal unit at BBC Hospital in 1998. And we will enjoy his lecture, and I will hand over to RSV Krishna for other proceedings.
Thank you, President. Dr. Sri Krishna. Am I audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
I wholeheartedly invite all the participants who are joining our 13th IAP-TCB webinar. And as you know, today's topic is non-invasive ventilation. The reason for choosing this topic is nowadays, most of the intensive care units, intensives are gradually moving from non-invasive to invasive. It's, as President CNED said, it's simpler, easier, and giving good results for the infants, neonates, and children. So with these few introductions, I thought for this, the best person would be none other than our Dr. Surapaneni Suresh Kumar. As Dr. CNED said, he was the first MCI qualified neonatologist in then United Andhra Pradesh, which includes Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. Secondly, amazingly, he had started his practice on the first day of this millennium, that is, on the first year of this 21st century. And he had really brought in the revolutionary changes in neonatal care in then Andhra Pradesh, of course, in Hyderabad, in all other places. So with these few remarks, I request our moderator, Dr. Pritham, another brilliant neonatologist. He did his fellowship in neonatology and is a strong pillar for the Rainbow Children Hospital. So thanks to our speaker, Dr. Suresh, and our moderator, Dr. Pritham, for accepting our invitation. I hand over mic to Dr. Pritham. Over to Pritham. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a kind introduction. And it has been a privilege and honor to introduce Dr. Suresh. Dr. Suresh actually was my teacher. I worked with him in Nilofer Hospital. And sir has done his undergraduation from Kakatiya Medical College and passed out in 1989. And did his MD Pediatrics from Nilofer and passed out in 1994. And did his DM neonatology in PGI and passed out in 1996. And he's finished his FRCPCH also. He's got the fellowship. He did that in May 2017. He was briefly for a little while in Nilofer, and after that, he has started his own practice and hospital, Pragna Children's Hospital, which also has DNB pediatrics, and he's a well-known center for academic excellence. Without wasting too much of time, we all know about Dr. Suresh, and he's a brilliant neonatologist, and I hand it over to him to take it forward. Sir, over to you, sir.
Dr. Suresh, you're unmuted. The rest of the participants will all be muted through the session. Dr. Suresh, you may start. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you very much. At the outset, I would like to thank the IAP-TCB team, Dr. C. N. Reddy Garu, Dr. Bhaskar, for giving, and other team members, and Dr. Sri Krishna for making this happen. And I would like to thank Pritham for the kind words of my introduction. So non-invasive ventilation in neonates, this is a topic which we have been thinking that we should do a session or a workshop for last almost 4 to 5 years. So many things you might be knowing, but if you see NICU, whenever we go to any NICU, we used to see a lot of noise from ventilator alarms and a lot of noise from the compressors. But now when this non-invasive ventilation started, NICUs have become like very quiet. So it's very easy to babies to sleep because there won't be much noise from this non-invasive ventilation, and even babies tolerate it very well. So we thought we'll look at it a critical way, how it has become popular, why it is important, and how to go about it. Much of my interest came from using CPAP way back in Niloufar, then subsequently in practice, and all the days, means this 2021, I'll be finishing 25 years of completing DM neonatology. So as we see, this is the future, what I think, which is in the days to come.
Dr. Suresh, you'll have to use Alt Tab. Yeah, I think now it's working. Please go ahead.
So why this is important? So bronchopulmonary dysplasia or chronic lung disease, main problem is intubation. And CPAP is the one which is very popular, but on CPAP, sometimes in babies with poor respiratory effort and all, CPAP won't work. Almost 46 to 60% fail CPAP, those babies with RDS. And almost nearly 25 to 40% of intubated babies fail extubation to CPAP. So this invasive ventilation is the one which is the major culprit for this chronic lung disease or bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So this invasion means once we put a tube, that is the one which will cause more pressure into the lungs, more volute trauma, more atelectative trauma, and more biotrauma, means more inflammatory mediators, which will cause the ventilator-induced lung injury. So even a single breath, which is given at birth, also can increase the inflammation and may contribute to chronic lung disease. So how it started? Is it new? So if you see non-invasive negative pressure ventilation, which is called iron lungs, were very popular in the decades of poliomyelitis. Say like the pandemic which is going on now, when polio pandemics were there, these iron lungs were the one which was used during those days. Like that, out of every adverse situation, there is a positive thing, something will come out. But now that iron lungs are no more popular, what we see more is non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. So what are the things what we are looking at? Say, to support ventilation and to avoid invasive support, intermittent positive pressure ventilation is given through nose. So continuous CPAP, all of you know. So CDAP means continuous distributing pressure is given through nasal route. On the top of it, a positive pressure cycle is delivered. So it means that you will ventilate through nose. So what are the types what we have? Here, non-invasive itself, you can divide into two groups by constant airway pressure or variable airway pressure. Within the constant airway pressure, you have CPAP, which is very popular. Within CPAP, there are constant flow and variable flow, conventional and bubble CPAPs. Whereas if you see the variable airway pressure, you have the nasal IPPV, nasal synchronized IPPV, then nasal BiPAP, and nasal high frequency ventilation. And in the constant airway pressure, there is another group called simple nasal cannula, giving low flow nasal cannula or high flow nasal cannula. So today we'll be focusing more on these things, CPAP, NIPPV, nasal BiPAP, nasal high frequency, and high flow nasal cannula. This HFNC also is otherwise called HHFNC, means heated high frequency nasal cannula. So these are the ones which are going on. So how these things are given? So each of them, I may not be going into the details, but in this table, I try to summarize what are the settings, what we commonly use. CPAP means it's a single continuous pressure, which we give at 6 to 8 liters, and pressure we give around 4 to 6, and we may go up to 8. And this CPAP can be given through ventilator, through influent flow driver, or through bubble CPAP. So how these things will generate ventilator, there is an expiratory valve. Influent flow driver, there is kinetic energy of flow. And bubble CPAP, distal expiratory tubing is kept in water with 5 to 10 liters pressure. So these are the ones which all of us know. The new things which are there is NIPPV. In NIPPV, there are two pressure levels, in non-synchronized and synchronized. So they are variable depending on the device strategy, and it may mimic CMV or SIMV. And within this, there is another new mode called nasal BiPAP. We will see what this nasal BiPAP is. There is another nomenclature called DOPAP. So DOPAP is spontaneous breathing on two CPAP levels. Then there is a nasal high frequency oscillation, which is mimicking the high frequency oscillation what we drew to ET tube. And lastly, there is high flow nasal cannula, where a flow dependent PEEP will be generated. So whatever more than 2 liters per minute flow is there, without any pressure control, we can generate PEEP. So we'll go to high frequency nasal cannula at the end. So these are the various methods to summarize. We'll see onto each of them, how they make the life easy for the preterm units. So this is a sample screen of the ventilator what we use, so which is of Acutronics. You can see here, this is a DOPAP. You can see here PDO, the various settings which are there. And this is the one which is BiPAP. If you see BiPAP closely, the low airway pressure, lowest is around 4 to 6, and high is around 8 to 10. And the inspiratory time is very high, 0.7 to 1. And rates are very low. So depending on the need, we'll adjust the FiO2. This is the wave pressure for showing BiPAP. Anyone can recognize this slide? This slide is taken from Clinics in Perinatology, published on non-invasive ventilation in 2016. Anyone can recognize? This is the slide where first head box CPAP was given. So first trial of CPAP, which is given by Gregory in 1971. This is the picture, high resolution image from that study. So they used up to pressures of around 12 on head box. And it was very successful, and later whatever is there is history. So 1971, now 2021. So almost so many years have lapsed. And over time it has changed a lot. So the CPAP is the one where we had lot of workshops, we know a lot about it. But brief to summarize, I'm not dealing much about CPAP, but brief to summarize how it works. It works through preventing collapse of alveoli, stabilizing the chest wall, splinting the upper airway, stretching the lungs and pleura. Ultimately, it leads to maintaining proper lung at FRC, reduces work of breathing and reduces apnea, and giving better oxygenation, better ventilation by reducing CO2 and better pH. So all these will reduce the pulmonary vascular resistance. All of you know this. So how you generate CPAP? CPAP can be generated using positive pressure in the circuit, what we have seen in the earlier slide, using continuous or variable flow. For CPAP, we need 3 things. One, a generator. We need a gas source of continuous, warm, humidified, blended gases. And we need a patient interface or delivery system. So these are the 3 things which are required for using CPAP. So this pressure generator, all of you know, if you are using ventilator, the flow valve will be there. And or we can use a device where continuous airflow is there in opposite direction to expiratory limb. And other method is bubble CPAP, which is very popular. So this bubble CPAP, commercial one, is very popular now. But I remember in the days of 1991, when I joined my DM under Professor Dr. Sudarshan Reddy Garu, for whom I dedicate this lecture. During those days, bubble CPAP was made in Nilofer, and we showed the presentation in an NNF conference, and Nilofer unit was awarded prize for that. So now CPAP is readily available, thanks to so much of companies which have come and started making this. And this bubble CPAP, how the pressure is generated. So it was very surprising. Whenever you go near bubble CPAP, lot of sound will come. So bubble CPAP, it's not the pressure itself. There is a continuous flow. There is something called stochastic resonance. So the noise which comes through bubbles, that bubbles itself will generate high frequency, that air currents itself. In addition to that, that sound itself will go till distal alveoli, and that is the one which will complete the cycle and will create proper lung compliance and will expand the lung. So the stochastic resonance is the one which is mechanism unique to bubble CPAP. And in addition to that, we have other methods like flow devices, flow driven things, what we use, the various companies. So coming to the patient interface with CPAP, many of us use nasal prongs. We used to get Hudson prongs, which we used to, earlier days in 90s, we used to get as donation. Our Professor Dr. Vidyasagar used to get prongs whenever he comes from US. Now everything is available. We also have nasopharyngeal prongs. We have nasal masks. We have nasal cannulas. We have so many brands of nasal prongs like Hudson, Fisher-Paykel, Argyll. The size selection is more important, having proper one. And if you use very tight, then necrosis will come. If you use very loose one, leak will come. And this breed should not abut the columella. There should not be any blanching. Nasal injuries are very common with CPAP and one of the common side effects. So these things, everything we should do to prevent that injuries. So these are the various things what we can see. The nasal mask, Fisher-Paykel prongs, the Hudson prongs, Argyll prongs, Wigan, nasopharyngeal prongs, we can see, and cannulate. So how these things will compare with each other? Nasal prongs are very simple and low resistance is there because of that greater transmission of pressure is there. And mouth itself will work like a pop-off mechanism. But only problem with prongs is difficult to fix. There is trauma to nasal septum and turbinates, and there will be leak through mouth, which makes the PEEP variable. But many studies have shown they are very useful than nasopharyngeal prongs. And these nasopharyngeal prongs, olden days, we used to use even a cut and dendritic tube. Now you get ready from some companies, Wigan and all. So easily available, fixation is easy. Only problem is they are blocked easily by secretions and easily they are kinked. So here we keep the prong by measuring test between earlobe to tip of chin or nose. And directly you can see behind uvula that you can see the prongs. And in addition, we have nasal cannulae, we have nasal mask, but still they are not very popular. So we'll go on to NIPPV, how it different from CPAP. So NIPPV, it offers the advantage of CPAP, like stabilization of air, alveoli by positive airway pressure it offers. In addition to that, it promotes better ventilation by delivering positive pressure breaths to lower airway. And this NIPPV will trigger a augmented inspiratory reflex in preterm infants, which is called Head's paradoxical reflex. And this will cause less inflammation than synchronized IMV. So many studies have shown that inflammatory mediators in NIPPV in lung tissue are very less. From lung secretion, they have studied the inflammatory mediators are very less, which will contribute to less incidence of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So there are many randomized control trials of NIPPV, but the problem is they use wide range of peak pressures, wide ventilator rates, variable inflation times. Some are synchronized, some are non-synchronized. So both can be used in non-synchronized mode. And how to give this NIPPV non-invasive positive pressure ventilation is through short binasal prongs, two masks, through long nasopharyngeal tubes, all can be used. And how to synchronize the breaths? So we can use pneumatic capsule, we can use neurally adjusted ventilator assistance called NAVA, which we'll see later. We can use flow triggering, we can use pressure triggering, we can use respiratory inductance plethysmography. There are various methods which are used in various devices. So these are the devices what we can see. The infant star ventilator with star sync. This is the one which is used in many studies, but now it has become obsolete, is no longer supplied. What we see more is infant flow CIPAP from Viasis, which is marketed in India by a company called CareFusion. So this Viasis is the one which is the middle one, which is there in this picture, is very popular. 2017, I went to UK for a few months. In that, I have seen almost all the units have this device. And most of the babies are onto this device, and the conventional ventilation is almost minimal. Only less than 5 to 10% are on ventilator. And many are using this device, which is there in the middle. This is CIPAP ventilator, which is from Viasis. And we can also use Synchrony from Pruritan Bennett. And Gulia from Ginevri with a special flow transducer. It can have all the types of NIPPVs, what we are mentioning. And there is a new ventilator for NAVA called Makert Servo I. Servo I we have in Pragna with NAVA option. But only thing is, we'll see at the end why these things are not yet so common. And we can also do nasal high frequency oscillation using this Acutronic, which is the first one which is there in the picture. So last one to the right is Gulia ventilator from Ginevra, Italy. Is synchronization is required at all? One, patient triggered nasal IMV, only when glottis is open, the inflation can be transmitted effective to the lungs. So if lattice is open, then only whatever you deliver into the nose and nasopharynx can go into the lungs. So that's why synchronization is very much essential. And many studies have shown with synchronization only, the results are better. And how it works? This nasal IPPV itself will improve patency of upper airway by increasing the pharyngeal pressures. So intermittent elevation, inflation of pharynx itself will activate this respiratory drive. So pharynx itself will activate respiratory drive, and inside the lungs, there will be this head's paradoxical reflex by lung inflation. So this itself will make the baby breathe. So in case of apnea, once we start giving breaths, baby's breathing itself may start. And even work of breathing also is says to be reduced with the use of NIPPV compared to CPAP. So we know how to start, but how to take out this NIV, that is still not very clear, but these are the various approaches what we see. Sometimes what we do is this nasal CPAP itself we remove suddenly. Sometimes we reduce, say if we are in around 8, we'll come down to around 4 to 6, then we can remove. Otherwise we do cycling, means daily we'll remove for few hours, then which can be increased gradually. Means first day I'll take out for about 2 hours, second day I may increase to around 6 hours off, slowly I'll take out. Sometimes we stop this and we start low flow oxygen, and a combination of one of this. So everything, the treating clinician, neonatologist has to sit bedside, see the effort and see how the baby is tolerating. And with methylxanthines, particularly caffeine, these things can be given in addition to these things to stop this NIPPV. So what are the various methods what we give this non-invasive ventilation? So primary mode means giving it soon after birth or within 2 hours of intubation for surfactant delivery followed by extubation. This is the primary mode. So many studies are there in this primary mode. And secondary mode means using after a long period, means more than 2 hours to days after intubation. So whatever hours you intubate, that itself may cause a mark on the lung inflammation. So that's why these two studies are, these two modes are used commonly in the studies. So NIPPV during apnea will increase tidal volume by only 5%, because on closed glottis, NIPPV will not work. So non-invasive positive pressure ventilation for apnea of prematurity, there are randomized studies with small number of invents of short duration. But the what Cochrane review says, it may be useful method to augment the beneficial effects of CPAP in preterm infants with apnea that is frequent or severe. So still studies are required. At the end, we'll see the latest Cochrane data. And second indication, what they use this NIPPV is to prevent post-extubation failure. So NIPPV reduced respiratory failure post-extubation to a significant extent. And these effects are much more in synchronized NIPPV. And third indication is NIPPV or nasal CPAP for preterm with RDS. So this also, we'll see the latest Cochrane data which has come. Only criticism on NIPPV was, there are not many babies who are below 1 kg, but this is one study, randomized trial below 30 weeks in whom 38% of NIPPV group died or survived with BPD versus 36% in this. There is no difference in this. But the later studies, these are studies which are done before 2016, but later a lot of studies have come. So is it safe? First, many studies were small and not sufficiently powered to detect serious complication. Only thing which was noticed was abdominal distension, but it was not clinically significant. NAC rates are unaffected by use of NIPPV, and even compared to nasal CPAP, the nasal complications like nasal septum erosion and trauma, clearly studies were not powered, but it's similar to nasal CPAP. But nowadays some studies have shown that NIPPV, the incidence of nasal complications are lesser. So these are the primary mode synchronized NIPPV studies, primary mode by Santin et al. And Bhandari et al. What they showed is this synchronized NIPPV has shorter duration of intubation and need for oxygen, shorter duration of hospitalization and TPN. And Bhandari also showed less incidence of BPD and death or BPD both together. So secondary mode also, they have shown synchronized NIPPV, less failed extubation at 48 hours at 3 days and at 7 days. So a lot of studies are there. So Kugelman is the one who has done studies on NAPPV compared to nasal CPAP, where they have shown that NAPPV itself reduced the intubation rate from 49 to 25%. So from almost half to one-fourth, and below 1500 gram for 60 to 30%. It's almost half. The intubation rate is reduced. And another study from Brazil by Menezes, who told unsynchronized also is beneficial in more than 1000 gram babies requiring surfactant. And long back, Sai Sunil Kishore from PGI, they have shown, they have used that nasal IPPV versus CPAP, and they showed the benefit is more in neonates between 28 to 30 weeks and those who are not requiring surfactant. Even from Lucknow, Avasthi et al., they have used nasopharyngeal tube and compared with head box, and they told NAPP is very beneficial. And in 2016, I met Ramanathan in one of the conferences where he shared this randomized control trial of 110 infants where there is reduced extubation failure and chronic lung disease. So this Ramanathan is the one who is popular for his Ram's cannula, and he has done a lot of work on this NAPPV and ventilation. And even in our journal, Indian Pediatrics, there have been a systematic trial which showed NAPPV versus CPAP. The extubation failure in NAPPV was significantly low compared to CPAP. Odds ratio was 0.15. So one word about BiPAP. BiPAP is two-level ventilation. So this is a popular study from Lista, which is published in Archives in 2010, where they have shown that bilevel CPAP is associated with better respiratory outcome versus nasal CPAP. It allowed earlier discharge and with same changes in cytokine levels, and which was well tolerated. And recent study in 2013, it showed nasal SIPPV and BiPAP. There they compared BiPAP and CPAP. Here they compared nasal SIPPV and BiPAP, which they showed similar results. So now we'll go on to, now we covered CPAP, we covered the NAPPV, we'll go on to the high flow nasal cannula, which has become very popular in last 5 years. And high flow nasal cannula means people think it's just giving oxygen therapy, what is there in this, but there is a lot beyond this. So any cannula which can give a gas flow more than 1 liter is considered high flow. People think high flow means it should give so and so like that. It's not true. More than 1 liter, whatever is there, it's called high flow. And HFNC means delivery of blended, heated and humidified oxygen. Means if you give just oxygen through normal tubes, which will not be blended and heated, that will not be high flow nasal cannula. So this approximates the physiological air conditioning which is there in the upper airway. Means when we intubate and do, even though we give humidified one, all the upper airway safety mechanisms are gone. This will not happen with high flow nasal cannula. So main thing in high flow nasal cannula is preconditioning of inspired gas. Because normally if we give cold gas, our metabolic energy of the body has to be spent to warm and humidify the air we breathe. So this high flow nasal cannula can reduce the resting energy expenditure. So people also may ask, CPAP also uses warm humidified gas. Is it same? But an in vivo study has shown that humidity delivered by high flow nasal cannula is significantly greater than CPAP. So how this works? So this high flow nasal cannula reduces work of breathing by reducing the inspiratory resistance, by washing out the nasopharyngeal dead space, and by providing the positive airway distending pressure, which is nothing but CPAP. And here it is flow dependent. So what are the devices which are available? So the devices what we have is OptiFlow system, which is from Airvo. Airvo 2 is available now, Fisher-Paykel. IAP Twin Cities has gracefully given this Airvo devices to Niloufar Gandhi. And many hospitals have this Airvo devices. And there is another method device, Precision Flow from Vapotherm. Vapotherm is a popular company. Lot of data is there. But unfortunately, Dräger used to deal some years back. Now there are no dealers listed for India. There is some more company called Comfort Flow, which is less known in India. So what is important in this high-flow nasal cannula? Cannula size is very important. And outer diameter of cannula should not be more than 50% of internal diameter of nares. So that's why, because it's not tightly fitting, It should not be more than 50. So that's why baby is tolerated very well. And here flow rate is size dependent. So people use, Ensure is very popular now. Means we intubate, use surfactant and extubate. After that, people use this high flow nasal cannula. So one study, they have shown 70% of HFNC group did not require reintubation again. This study had 45 infants with mean gestation of 27 weeks. And there are many studies, HFNC versus CPAP. Over times we went for primary support, means directly they use this only. What they told was, if you use high flow nasal cannula versus CPAP, 5 studies of primary support, they told there is no difference. And 2 studies didn't assess respiratory failure, but they saw the pain and discomfort scores. So high flow nasal cannula was having less pain and was accepted better. And crossover study also was done in 20 preterm, showing no differences in the treatment. So many studies showed that it is good and as well as it's well tolerated with less pain and discomfort. And how it is advantageous over CPAP, which is very popular now. So CPAP started in 1981, and now even after say many years, we use it routinely now because many, it's very available and we had a learning curve. But this heated high flow nasal cannula is better tolerated by infant. As soon as you put CPAP, some babies tolerate well, but some babies become restless and start crying a lot. And even there is problem of nasal injuries, which is less with high flow nasal cannula. And you can give sucking feeds, you can give kangaroo care more easily compared to CPAP. So this high flow nasal cannula, recent Cochrane review, so 15 studies were published, it is not updated again. So what they have told is, 3 indications they have seen, 1 post-extubation support, 1 primary support soon after birth, and third one is weaning from CPAP. So primary support, there were 4 studies of 439 infants, and no difference in outcome and no difference in primary or secondary outcomes or chronic lung disease. And following extubation as post-extubation support, there were 6 studies of 934 infants. There are no differences in treatment failure or reintubation. And there was lesser incidence of pneumothorax, but the numbers are very small. If you see, the confidence intervals are very wide and they are crossing 1. The typical risk difference is only 0.02. So numbers are very marginal. And third indication, weaning from CPAP, 2 studies are there who told weaning from CPAP preterm means CPAP, you can wean off directly on CPAP or you can randomize onto HFNC. They told reduced duration of hospitalization compared to infants who remained on CPAP. So all these 3 Cochrane review also says the results are positive. But all said and done, there are some things which are there versus CPAP. So there is a hipster trial, which is popular. The trial was stopped midway, where most of these studies, trial designs were non-inferiority designs. Means nasal CPAP and high flow nasal cannula is used. And this is not inferior. This was the study design. And as soon as interim analysis showed there are some failures, they stopped it. There is another randomized control trial by our own Srinivas Murki, which was also stopped after interim analysis, showing more failure in the high flow nasal cannula group. So we'll see these things before we jump onto using more high flow nasal cannula. So this is a trial by Srinivas Murki and team, who means did study on preterm infant more than 1,000 gram, who were randomized to either high flow nasal cannula or CPAP in non-inferiority trial. So they had 139 and 133 infants, which are randomized to nasal CPAP and high flow nasal cannula group. So what they have seen is, after interim analysis, treatment failure was higher in high flow nasal cannula group. Means out of 35 patients who failed, 32 were rescued with CPAP. And because this treatment failure was higher, they discontinued the study, and they told high flow nasal cannula is inferior to nasal CPAP in avoiding need for higher mode of respiratory support in first 3 days of life. So this is the one what they came out. And subsequently, during that time, many other studies also were done. So this is a study, means there, I told you already, there are 2 devices what are used. One is from Fisher-Paykel and other is Vapotherm. So this high flow nasal cannula, which is done by probably means Srinivas Murky and team, and in this Manley and Roberts, what they have shown here, what they have used it, they have used our Airvo, which is from Fisher-Paykel. Whereas Collins and others, they have used this Vapotherm, and Lavizari and Kugelman, all these people used Vapotherm. So they have seen various things. Post-extubation support, the endpoint was reintubation within 7 days. What they told is in Collins' study, the CPAP failure was 3.4 and HFNC failure was around 22%. Whereas if we see in Manley study, similar endpoint, 34 and 26%. And as primary support for RDS also, the failure rates were much lesser. And primary support for RDS taking endpoint in less than 35 weeks and 28 weeks to 35 weeks, in those also, the results are very different. So what they told was that the Hipster study used mostly, means only 6% of babies who are in that Hipster study were used this Vapotherm. Rest of them, mostly they used Airvo. And Airvo is the one which were not giving enough results, and probably there is a difference in comparison with CPAP. So that's why this recent study we got. So why we are getting different results with different studies? So this is the one which has caught my attention, which is published in Archives in 2020, January, means few months back. So this is a study where they did a crossover study. I mean, this is not a study for comparing outcomes. What they compared is, what are the physiological effects of high-flow nasal cannula therapy in preterm infant, and what are the pressures which are generated? So what they have done is, they have done a crossover study, and they have three weight groups, less than 1,000 grams, 1,000 to 1,500, and more than 1,500 grams. Initially, we see the study design in detail, and we see what happened in detail. So this is the study design, less than 37 weeks, weights between 500 to 1,900 grams. They were randomized. So what they have done, NIV support, inclusion criteria is those who are on CPAP or HFNC, age more than 3 days. These people they have taken, they're randomized into two groups, group one and group two. So group one initially were on CPAP, group two was on HFNC. So between 30 to 60 minutes, they changed CPAP group to HFNC 8, then 7, then 6, then slowly they came up to 2. Then at the end of 120 minutes, they switched back onto original support. Like that, same HFNC group were changed onto CPAP, then they were switched after 2 hours. So what they have done is, they have measured the nasopharyngeal pressures, they measured the oxygen and CO2, they saw the TASCA CO2 readings, they saw the tidal breathing indices. They have measured the pressure to know which is working. So what they used in the measurements, they used this Fabian acutronic ventilator, what we shown earlier. They used these nasal prongs. They used the MR850 humidifier, what we use. Nasal CPAP interface used was from Armstrong Medical. And they measured nasopharyngeal and PEEP using this Argyll catheter connected to BD transducer. And they used the airflow to the catheter inlet to prevent the occlusion. And dead space washout was measured using nasopharyngeal end expiratory CO2 using AD instrument analyzer. And mouth open position, they recorded open naturally or closed. Like that for each HFNC flow rate. And they saw the tidal volume changes using this volume sense equipment. And transcutaneous CO2 they have used, and oxygen saturation and heart rate they used using Masimo pulse oximeter. So they try to record all the things, even the analyzer calibrations were done in a proper way. So what came out? So what they showed is flow rate, mouth position, current weight and gestation. These are the ones which predict that the PEEP, not the prong to nair ratio. I mean, prong to nair ratio was not that important compared to flow rate, mouth position, weight and gestation. And flow rate is the most important variable, followed by mouth position. And this is the predicted PEEP formula. And what they have shown is, if you put a PEEP of 6 with nasal CPAP of 6 across all weight groups, the PEEP which was given was 6.4, and which was higher than HFNC. And this is comparable to HFNC 8 liter per minute. Means if you put CPAP of 6 and HFNC of 6, CPAP 6 will give higher PEEP compared to HFNC 6. Whereas if you put CPAP 6 and HFNC 8, probably they will be comparable. But only problem is, in babies weighing below 1 kg, the mean PEEP with nasal CPAP was 5.4, whereas in HFNC, that was higher. So less than 1,000 grams, the HFNC of 7 to 8 liters was much higher than CPAP of 6. So smaller the baby, more pressure is generated. So what they told is flow rate is inversely related to pressure delivered, and less than 1 kg babies are there, which were included in this. And previously, lot of data is there on HFNC. Most of the thing means non-inferiority studies, the reason to fail in Ipsa trial, our Murkis trial and other trials, maybe due to different measurement techniques, small sample sizes, or narrow flow rate protocols. So we were not knowing what we were giving. So like this happened in CPAP. CPAP from 1981, it took almost 37 years to give grade A evidence. Lot of evidence came, but to make it universal and used everyone, it took so many more than 30 years. HFNC is still evolving. So what this study has shown is 8 liters per minute HFNC can be given compared to 6 centimeter water CPAP. And average CPAP of HFNC 6 is lower than CPAP of 6. So which may be relevant to the recent randomized studies where they have used both at same level. So that's why HFNC has shown as inferior to nasal CPAP in the primary support. And smaller babies will have more problem. And whenever you increase flow rate, the pressure will increase, when oxygenation will increase, rates will come down, and better alveolar ventilation will come by reduced dead space ventilation. So that's why we have to see in a proper way, we have to design more studies, and we have to be more clear before we use HFNC and wider note. Though many units are using it extensively, still means the data is not all that positive. Now we'll go on to the other mode which has come up, like NAVA. So NAVA is very good, exciting, lot of data, is small studies are there. What they do is they put a catheter called ED catheter, which is kept through a feeding tube, 5.5 feeding tube, which is kept in esophagus. So through that, the diaphragmatic electromyography will be taken to sense. Depending on time of breathing, it will give breath proportionate to electrical activity of diaphragm. So Steen et al, they have done studies and they showed how to use. But only thing is, this is a sample screen which shows how this NAVA is used. We have it, but only thing is whom to use, when to use, and who is the ideal candidate for this. And the main problem is the cost. This catheter itself is a disposable one, which is very expensive. That's why this, though it's promising, it will take time to come. And all of you are very happy with the high frequency oscillations, and nasal high frequency oscillation is also coming up. So they have done studies with term babies with RD, which showed good outcome. And in preterm also, the studies have come, which showed better CO2 clearance, and moderate to severe RD, 28 to 34 weeks also, better outcomes are noted. And some people may say that bubble CPAP also is said to be like high frequency oscillation. How different is this high frequency oscillation compared to bubble CPAP? So bubble CPAP, the oscillations are small, irregular, and no active expiratory phase. Whereas in nasal high frequency oscillation, there is a bias flow, and there is oscillations of constant frequency, and there is active expiratory phase superimposed on spontaneous tidal breathing. So there is a bias flow, constant flow, and oscillations of constant frequency and active expiratory phase. That's why this is different and this is more effective than bubble CPAP. So to summarize, lung protective strategies are very important because it's not the survival. Means earlier we used to have babies who are born after antenatal steroids, IVH is less, PDA is less, we thought we conquered, but then surfactant came, we thought surfactant has come conquered, then CLD came. Now our emphasis is to see the intact survival, just to go home early, to go with minimal damage to the brain and heart. So lung protective strategies are very important. So this synchronized ventilation, non-invasive ventilation is one of the method, but it's not that all. We have to do other things like using less pressure, using less invasion, and all said and done, for now, CPAP is the gold standard now. Nasal synchronized intermittent positive pressure ventilation is promising, evolving, and is very popular. 2/3 of neonatal units in UK, US, Australia, New Zealand, they are using this. Even many units in our Hyderabad, they are using this. But we need fine-tuning, but it definitely has a clear role. So we need to be there. And we have so many things in our armamentarium, like we can have this HFNC, then we can have CPAP, we can use any newer mode, we can use synchronized ventilation. So everything is done, this definitely has a role. So this is a model strategy, like if we get a baby with respiratory distress syndrome, first line what we do, we give surfactant, we give non-invasive ventilation initially, depending on the need, we may give surfactant. Even in surfactant, we can use, it's not just ensure LISA or least invasive surfactant or surfactant by inflation. There are so many methods. This we can discuss in a separate stage. And NIV, surfactant and caffeine, these things may settle many of the children. If child is not at all improving, then you go for this SIMV mode of ventilation or CMV or high frequency. And once we are through with that ventilation, once the baby recovered from that, again, you can come on to NIV. So you can see here, NIV is there in the middle, in the primary first line strategy itself, as well as in the... So this is there in our lives. So we can make the lives of newborn babies, preterm newborn especially, who are born, their lives here. So that treatment should not be painful than the having actual disease. So future directions. So surfactant and inhalation, what we told, NIV, nasal high frequency, NAVA, having better pulmonary mechanics and pressure monitoring to know exactly what we are doing and to safeguard against inadvertent higher pressures, and combined cerebral and respiratory monitoring. Cerebral monitoring also is important, because if you do non-synchronized ventilation, invasive or non-invasive, that may increase the risk of bleed. And automated FiO2 control means many times we are very lazy to reduce the FiO2, that may cause problems with oxygen toxicity. So newer devices are coming, reducing the oxygen automatically. So this also may come. And many neuroprotective drugs and ventilation strategies are coming, which are more individualized, institution-based, neonatologist-based, and all of you young doctors can do many things to save your babies in an intact way. So I thank you very much for the kind attention given to me. I hope we'll come back again. All of you will invent new things and will do more of non-invasive ventilation and reduce invasive ventilation to less than 5 to 10% as is there elsewhere in the world. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. That was a wonderful lecture. I think all of participants would have enjoyed it. There are a few questions, sir. I'll just put it out to you. One, I think, where do we fit bubble CPAP with newer HFNC? Can we be taken still as a primary or a VNOC mode? Please compare them.
Repeat the question again.
No, they're trying to say with bubble CPAP versus HFNC.
Yeah.
So can it be, which one can be taken as a primary mode? What is the evidence to it? And or weaning off mode? Do we differentiate that way, or you can take either of them as a primary mode and also as a weaning off mode, is the question.
So I means, say if the baby is less than 1 kg baby, I'll start with the bubble CPAP. But if the baby is 1 kg and above, so we can start with HFNC as the primary mode. So this is a studies what we showed. Means many studies have shown HFNC also can be used as primary mode. And last study I have shown even below 1 kg children also we can use HFNC as the primary mode. But only problem is you have to see how the child is responding. If the child is responding well, even if it is below 1 kg baby, if the baby is tolerating well, you can use HFNC as the primary mode.
Yes, sir. And the other question is upper airway problems, which is ideal, CPAP or HFNC? Especially more so post extubation strider or some sort of a little bit of laryngomalacia. So,
yeah. So recently we had a child who had laryngomalacia and bronchomalacia. We used HFNC. There was complete collapse of the lung, left lung, post extubation. We didn't intubate again. We used HFNC. So if you are using, if you put a endotracheal tube and if you see a lot of problem with the glottis and lot of laryngeal edema is there, HFNC can work wonders. And HFNC, the humidification also is better and tolerance also is better. So personally, nowadays we are using more of this HFNC. Only if the child is not maintaining with that, then you can go on to CPAP.
Yes. So another question is, nasal prongs versus mask. Which one is better to avoid more of barotrauma and also to avoid PIE?
So nasal prongs are very soft. This Fisher-Paykel one, what we use are the Hudson prongs are very soft. HFNC, if you see, the area will not cross more than 50% at any time. The ideal one, what we use. So that's why this is much better. Nasal mask is not that popular at all. Though it will cover various surface, the cushion masks are there. They are not easily available. And means clearly not much of experience is there and for many of us on use of this nasal mask. Nasal prongs are much more popular because they are more effective.
Yeah, I think it's got something to do with monitoring also.
It's not the use of particular brand or particular device. We are not for promotion of any brand. So constant monitoring of the site, constant monitoring of the child is important.
Yes, sir. I think it's got to do with the nursing also. Nurses, their workload increases where there is a mask because it keeps the baby keeps moving and the more chances of dislodgement.
Yeah.
The role of HFNC in acute bronchiolitis or above neonatal age, any role the HFNC in bronchiolitis and is the question.
HFNC is very popular in infants also. So bronchiolitis in infants as well as asthma in pediatric age group and in post-op periods, HFNC is well tolerated. So for children who are on home ventilation for chronic disease, for them also HFNC is being used as a home remedy. So pediatric uses of HFNC are also very popular. So this vapor therm and these things are given on rental in USA for pediatric patients who are on home ventilation. And now most of them, this AirVo, it doesn't require any air compressor. It will take air from the environment and we have to just connect oxygen. So for transport also, this can be useful for some stable patients for less than 30 or 40 minutes within the hospital. So for transport, for pediatric use, for bronchiolitis, there are many studies which showed improvement. Even with asthma, severe acute asthma, many studies have shown improvement. So there is definite role and it's a promising technology even for older age group. We can use for even up to it's not very big child also, you can use this HFNC. Very useful.
And one question from Dr. Lakshman Kumar. Best interfaces in NIV and what is open circuit mouthpiece ventilation? Indications for that.
I'm not, your voice is getting broken, Pritam.
Best interfaces in NIV.
Best interfaces.
Yeah.
Interfaces are short nasal prongs, which are less than 50%.
And the other question is, what is open circuit mouthpiece ventilation?
Open circuit mouthpiece ventilation. I'm not aware of that.
Sir, to be honest, Lakshman sir, if we can connect, because I also could not understand what is this open circuit mouthpiece ventilation. So,
Lakshman, if you can talk, please raise your hand. I'll unmute you. Meanwhile, let me just unmute Dr. Rangaya, who had lifted his hand. Dr. Rangaya, please go ahead.
Thank you. Suresh Surupanan garu, hello sir, how are you?
Hello andi Rangaya garu.
I'm in daytime in Cleveland, I'm here. And excellent lecture for especially postgraduates and many IAP and NNF fellowship candidates in Hyderabad. Very useful. I am proud to say that we are together in first, you are the first DM neonatologist in BBC on 9th August, BBC opened at the Himayatnagar crossroads. And at that time, we used to get cases from Kukatpally to Elbinagar, all the city and all the towns. And at that time, our newborn cases are more than pediatric. Really, I am remembering in those days and the best days. And anyhow, thank you very much, sir. Congratulate you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Yes, please go ahead.
Hello, Suresh. I am very happy to see you. Glad. Wish you all the best for the nice lecture. Yes, he was my Suresh was my undergrad students in KMC. అప్పుడు మేము ఒక ఐఏపి క్విజ్ కండక్ట్ చేసినాం. అప్పుడు సురేష్ సెలెక్ట్ అయ్యాడు. సెలెక్ట్ అయిన తర్వాత ప్రైజ్ కూడా వచ్చింది. అప్పుడు అడిగిన నేను సురేష్ని ఏంటంటే నాకు పీడియాట్రిక్ చాలా ఇంట్రెస్ట్ సార్ అని చెప్పిండు. సో ఐఎమ్ వెరీ గ్లాడ్ టు సీ యూ. ఆఫ్టర్ దట్ ఈ పాస్ జాయిన్ ఇన్ పీడియాట్రిక్స్. నాట్ ఓన్లీ దట్ ఈ జాయిన్ ఇన్ డిఎంఎన్ అండ్ ఈ ఫస్ట్ క్యాండిడేట్ టు డిఎం ఫ్రమ్ ఐఏపి. సో ఐఎమ్ వెరీ గ్లాడ్. విష్ యూ ఆల్ ది బెస్ట్ ఇన్ యువర్ ఫ్యూచర్ ఎండివర్స్ ఆల్సో సురేష్. అండ్ ఐఎమ్ ప్రౌడ్ ఆఫ్ యూ.
థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్ సార్.
బై.
థ్యాంక్ యూ సార్.
Prone position in NIV, we can use prone position in NIV because using prone position in NIV we can turn head to one side. And we can use prone position to recruit lower part of the lungs. Means basal part of lungs is better ventilated in prone position. In our NICU, we change the position even if you are on CPAP or NIV or NIPB. Every few hours, we change the position. So prone position is the one which is more recommended for preterm nowadays. So it's not a specific condition. It's our nursing protocol to change more frequently to achieve better things, because prone position is the one which makes the preterm sleep better, and better recruitment of alveoli will come, and child is more calm, crying will be less. Only problem is nursing people, they have to change it every few hours from prone to supine. That's the only thing. Only observation means in case baby is getting apnea, unless your monitors are good, clinically you may not be able to observe apnea if you are lying in prone position. But all other cases, as an indication, we use. Technically, I don't know any disease where we keep only prone position for NIV. Disease-wise, there is nothing. It's only a matter of nursing practice.
Yes, sir. Sir, there are a lot of postgraduates as well. What they want to would be interested in knowing also is, how is CPAP different from PWP? So I think most of the postgraduates, the first question they ask when you get onto the ventilator is, how is CPAP and PEEP different?
So, if you see CPAP, it is continuous positive airway pressure. Means throughout the pressure, it's maintaining one value throughout the ventilation. Whereas PEEP is positive end expiratory pressure. So, what remains at the end of expiration is positive end expiratory pressure. CPAP is continuous positive airway pressure. Means inspiration and expiration, the same pressure maintains. Whereas PEEP is what is left at the end of expiration, which is remaining. So PEEP refers to something in expiration phase of respiration, whereas CPAP refers to inspiratory and expiratory cycles.
Yes, sir. And suppose we've connected one patient on CPAP. So, sir, how do we monitor it? Basically, connection probably is easy and we just connect it and then go away. So how do we monitor it and what do we look out for, and what do we tell the nurse what to look out for?
So, monitoring on CPAP. So yes, we have to means one is monitoring the physical complication, like say if the baby is crying a lot, whether seal is there. Say babies move. Usually we don't sedate the CPAP babies much. So what we give is gentle relief only. So if they cry, that itself will work like pop of valve. That CPAP may not be effective. Sometimes some babies' nose is very sensitive, and sometimes the humidified oxygen, whatever we give, that itself may cause redness, edema. So every few hours, sister has to see if the CPAP prongs are out of place. She has to reposition, see the cannula, and sometimes if it is red, she has to remove and make it into a small one. And if it is already red, then she has to call the concerned doctor and start treating it. And sometimes if we see lot of redness and local complications, we can change on to HFNC or try to wean off CPAP at the earliest. So monitoring in CPAP are three things. One, monitoring the respiratory condition, which is using your down score and FIO2 requirement. Second, monitoring of CPAP effectiveness, whether enough bubbles are coming, whether flow is maintained. And sometimes inadvertently, they may increase the flow, which may increase CPAP. And using proper blending or not. If blender is there, it's kept on proper position or not. So usually weaning in CPAP is not done only by pressure. We reduce FiO2, then we reduce CPAP, then we take out. And third thing is monitoring of local complications of CPAP on headband, how it is kept. Some people use various plasters. As far as possible, use transparent ones and always check and reposition as frequently as possible. It's more of nurse responsibility, but ultimately if any complications happen, they ask only doctor. Nobody will ask nurse.
Yes.
We are sitting on top of all things to take the brunt.
Yes, sir. One of the doctors, Dr. Arvind, had asked about what nasal injury scoring system we can use.
There are various grading systems like erythema, redness, edema, various things are there. But it's not, say, if I say score is some 3 or 4, doesn't mean I'll take out. We want to, at earlier stage of redness only, you have to remove rather than wait for advanced grade. So though they are there, we don't use much.
Yes, sir. And so when do you say failure of NIV, sir?
So whenever, say, you reach the phase where, say, CPAP is there, or NIV is there, you reach then 60% FiO2, you reach the maximum pressure, still not maintaining, still baby is unstable. Whenever blood pressure is less or respiratory effort itself is less, you reach the stage and you feel baby, as soon as you NIV is successful, the chest retractions will reduce. Baby will become more quiet. Oxygenation also will be maintained. Whenever you are having increasing oxygen requirement, increasing Silverman-Anderson score, increasing fluctuations in the baby's condition, then we can take. It's a relative word. It's a bedside thing what we take and decide. But if I have to requirement higher, non-painting in maximal settings on NIV and clinical condition of the baby. Means we correlate with chest X-ray, clinical condition and the settings used. If you feel baby is not improving, then we can change. So NIV failure is a relative term.
Yes. So you would say most of the times it is whatever monitoring on CPAP or failure of CPAP is primarily clinical. I think the clinician along with his team, somebody has to be around and they need to keep titrating things rather than, you know, doing a remote control job. I think that's what the sir wants to say. And next question, sir, is ABG important on NIV? Now, can we do away with it and how do we monitor?
So monitoring, as we told, is more clinical. But clinical monitoring, even if you do, like in invasive ventilation, we don't do very frequent ABGs, but at least once a day to know. Because the pulse oximeter will tell about the oxygen saturation. Based on that, we can reduce the oxygen. But to know the CO2, means we used to use this transcutaneous monitoring for a period of time. But that also, you need a heated electrode. So unless you reposition that electrode, we used to use radiometer one. So in many studies also, they have used the transcutaneous. If that is there, you need not do much ABGs. But if it is not there, at least less frequently, means 12 to 24 hourly, you need to know, because if CO2 is raised, nowadays even of CO2 of 40 to 60, we are not discontinuing this non-invasive ventilation. We are continuing with that. We are tolerating higher CO2s provided babies clinically is doing better. Better means less chest retractions, stably decreasing the oxygen concentration, and baby is also perfusion wise and otherwise if baby looks better, then we can take it as success. But once a day at least, we have to do ABG. But it's not mandatory. After a period of time, we can monitor clinically also of the baby's brain. But at least once or twice we need to do, but not that frequently like in the regular ventilation.
Yes, sir. So primarily your PCO2 is a concern, because PO2, SPO2, you can always keep looking up in the monitor. PCO2 definitely is a concern because you won't be able to monitor it. It's the main concern here.
Yeah.
I think HFNC wise, probably PCO2 would be lesser because you have a lot of dead space washout. So that is one thing which probably.
If we are using end-expiratory CO2, ETCO2 monitor, HFNC will not work because you are washing out the dead space. The dead space is required for monitoring the end-expiratory CO2. That's why in the study, which is published recently. Yeah. They have seen the transcutaneous one.
No, no, sir. I didn't say ETCO2. I said PCO2 gets washed off in HFNC. So that way, probably you are little okay with PCO2 when you put the HFNC is what I was trying to tell you. Sorry. Yeah. So the other one is, sir, how do you synchronize? You have told about NIPPV getting synchronized, but normally, traditionally, in any ventilatory circuit, you either have a flow sensor which detects a drop in the volume, and then that is when it synchronizes. Yeah. So how do you synchronize in a non-NIB or NIP? No,
the ventilators, what we told, like CareFusion one or the one which is Acutronics one, all of them, they have flow triggering. Most of the ventilators, what we use in current days, they have flow triggering. So either you can use an electrode to detect, like in NAVA, means where esophageal electrode is there. Or sometimes you have electrode on the abdominal wall, like Gracevy capsule, which is there in Infant Star, olden days. So those things are not there now. Most of the time, it's the flow and pressure sensors are there, which are there in the ventilator itself. So because of that, we can synchronize. It will sense the breathing and it will synchronize the breath. Only when you give synchronized on open glottis, the pressure can come. Otherwise, you deliver pressure only up to nasopharynx. And because the glottis is closed, it cannot go in. So that's why olden studies with non-synchronized IPPV, they were not much useful when compared to CPAP. After the synchronization come only, this synchronized IPPV has shown that it's worth competing with CPAP. Here also, this competition with CPAP, though it's in studies, what we feel is we should not take it as a competition. We should take it as one by one. Means if I don't like one, I can use the other one immediately. Don't take that we are taking sites of CPAP or HFNC or IPPV. Whatever is there, use whichever is for the best outcome of the patient. That is more important.
Sir, question from Dr. Bhaskar. Sir, ROP and BPD incidence, is it, how is it? Is it better with CPAP or NIV as compared to the traditional ventilation?
So NIV is also ventilation. Though it is non-invasive, that also is a ventilation. And there also ROP is not a disease which is concerned only with one. So basically this NIV has come to reduce the incidence of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So those things are lesser. Lesser in some studies, not all studies. Many studies in olden days means before 2012, they have shown the incidence is almost equal. But now recent studies have come where we pass some learning curve and we have shown the bronchopulmonary dysplasia is less. But regarding ROP, I don't think there is any much different between non-invasive and invasive ventilation. ROP, many studies, Cochrane data also says the incidence of ROP in non-invasive as well as invasive ventilation is not different.
It's primarily to do with the FiO2.
Finish. Yeah.
Yeah. BPD probably might be better off in NIV as compared to invasive ventilation. That is because the it's less invasive. So naturally, it is protective. Sir, other question, sir. Early feeds initiation and tolerance, is it better off in CPAP or better off in HFNC?
So two studies I have done which have shown that bubble CPAP will cause more abdominal distension. CPAP will cause more abdominal distension than HFNC. Because CPAP, unless baby opens mouth, there may not be pop-up. So because of that, CPAP belly, abdominal distension is the most common side effects of CPAP. Whenever distension is there, some stasis may be there. So that's why theoretically, yes. But practically what we have seen is giving minimal enteral feed, CPAP is never a problem. Many of our units give minimal feed. But advancing feed, initiation and tolerance, I have very limited data, but what they feel, only two studies are there which showed that you can increase feed faster because handling is easier. Means you can start KMC, you can start minimal enteral nutrition, and mother also can come and participate in the study. Whereas if you take CPAP, giving baby to the mother while on CPAP will cause more problem. Whereas in HFNC, because your nair surface is less than 50% and baby can move easily, the tubings are also not that cumbersome. If you see CPAP circuit, the weight is more. Whereas HFNC, the weight also is less. So nursing care-wise, it's easier. But technically, advancing tolerance, we may have to do a study to tell clearly. But in general, without any, as a general rule, HFNC, there should not be any reason where initiation and tolerance is difficult compared to CPAP.
Dr. Mallesh had a question. Sir, I am unmuted you. If you can ask, sir.
Good evening, Suraj Bhaiya.
Good evening, Bhaiya. Hello, Naro.
Bhavana, Bhaiya.
Chepandi.
Most of the peripheral centers are using CPAPs or some other ventilation without proper trained persons, including paramedics. Is there any iatrogenic injuries regarding NIV ventilation? Any data is there?
Yeah, CPAP particularly, because your nursing care is more important and nasal injuries are very common, and baby has to open the mouth, and if opens mouth, then CPAP will not be effective. If doesn't open mouth, high pressure may generate and that may cause pneumothorax. So CPAP, more incidence of pneumothorax, air leaks, abdomen distension, nursing is very much important. Whereas HFNC, too early, because now we don't have many. Compared to CPAP, HFNC is easier to use. But it doesn't mean in periphery centers we have any experience. So we don't have much data to say that nursing care is lesser and all. That is also important even in this. HFNC also may cause complications. It's not completely risk-free. Because still even in this, there are nasal prongs. We can't say that is safe. But right now, means sisters with moderate experience also can use HFNC. And nursing, you have to train the nurses. With them, you can use at periphery level safely.
Yes. Sir, Dr. Lakshman Kumar had a question, sir. I am unmuting, sir. Sir, you can...
Is ABG mandatory for CPAP? Because in periphery, it's a problem.
Yeah, yes, bhaiya. Congratulations.
Hello. Thank you, bhaiya.
For best interaction. Bhaiya. Only two questions. One is, you in the summary, you told that neuroprotective drug strategy. And another one is the ABG machine is mandatory in periphery. Because in the periphery, most of the people are using on a clinical basis CPAP. So please highlight that. What is that neuroprotective drugs you use while in NIV? And is the ABG machine is compulsory to use NIV?
Neuroprotective drugs, what we use is basically for pain relief.
Okay.
Pain relief, we use drugs like fentanyl. Fentanyl is the one which will cause sedation and pain relief. Because of that, so babies will not fight ventilation, they will not be struggling. There won't be increased risk of IC bleed.
Okay.
So sedation, pain relief, and that will also, baby also will tolerate all this non-invasive ventilation in a better way. So that is one. And olden days, some people used drugs. Antenatal steroid also is a neuroprotective strategy, use of antenatal steroid. And using less pressures and using less intubation during birth and using less surfactant, less invasive surfactant. All these are neuroprotective strategies only. Okay. So it's not one single term. It's a package of things. It's a bundle approach for neuroprotective strategies. Second thing is your ABG.
Yeah.
CPAP also is a ventilation. CPAP also is a ventilation. And if somebody is, contraindications of CPAP are metabolic acidosis and severe CO2 retention and poor respiratory effort. So to document that, we need at least one ABG. But we don't need, like, if you are running a regular ventilator, you may need ABG every 6th hourly or 12th hourly or 24th hourly. But if you are on CPAP, one way to avoid ABGs is to have ETCO2 monitor. Now many monitors are come, wherein end-tidal CO2 you can take and you can see as display. So, but only problem is in small babies, the tubes get blocked. And particularly the tube gets kinked and the CTCO2 monitor, that one may be disposable and that may add to the cost. So using ETCO2 monitor is one choice, which is one-time investment, little expensive, but it can save from ABG. And second option is using transcutaneous PCO2 monitor. Transcutaneous PCO2, if you have a lot of volume, say if you have more than 10 to 12 ABGs, then you can reduce to one per day using this transcutaneous, where continuously it will come. So what we used to use is, when many babies were there, transcutaneous we used to use for one for some hours, then remove and put for some other baby. Based on that, we can reduce the number of ABGs. But CPAP also is ventilation. You need ABG at least initially to start with. Later, if baby condition changes.
Thank you.
Moderately sick, you don't need repeated ABGs.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Bhaiya. Thank you.
Dr. Bandaru had a question, sir. Sir, I'm unmuting you. You're there, sir?
Yeah. Bandaru, sir. Tell me.
Hello. Yeah, sir. Good evening. Good evening, it's a nice presentation.
Yes, thank you.
I have a doubt. Like, you know, in a COVID situation where if we can get an infant or a pediatric patient, is NIV, I think, got a better perspective than interventional ventilation?
Yeah, definitely. Intubation, all these things will increase risk of, say, if child is already positive, if child neonate is positive, so intubation is one potential risk. Using NIV is better. So NIV is better than invasive ventilation to reduce the risk. But NIV also, during NIV also, you take the nasal prongs and ventilation will go into the lungs and return will come out through nasal prongs. So that is also, NIV itself also may generate that virus particles may come out through ventilation. So through NIV also, there is a risk if newborn baby is affected. And we can use this in COVID disease. NIV can be used in respiratory distress, but reducing the need for invasive ventilation, we can't say. Because NIV is more uncontrolled, means we don't know what pressures we are giving. And if the patient COVID, most of the time, the disease what is there is ARDS. So ARDS is the one where the strategies of ventilation are different. Yeah. NIV is more suitable for young children, small children who are having RDS, much of the data. Adults, other diseases, there is data, but still we can't say that is the first line of choice. Only for chronic patients, it's more used. Some conditions, it is more used. NIV is not one of them. COVID is not one of them in adults. For newborn, definitely compared to invasive, NIV will reduce the risk of transmission from baby to us.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Yes, sir. I think we come to the end of questions, sir. I think no further questions. Yes, sir. Now I ask Dr. Krishna, Bhaskar sir, and CN Reddy sir. Over.
Dr. CN Reddy sir, you are unmuted. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Dr. Suresh.
Thank you, sir.
Very excellent lecture. It was more informative and more evidence-based, and it was more practical. And we all learned so many things, especially HFNC and its advantages. You have clearly explained. And thank you very much for accepting our invitation and coming and giving a lecture. And I thank Pritam Kumar for making this session lively and more interactive. And I also thank RVS Krishna for coordinating this program. And thank you, everybody. Namaste to all.
Thank you, Dr. CN Reddy. My special thanks to Dr. Surabhrani Suresh Kumar for the brilliant presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Which is very comprehensive and covering all the aspects of NIV, looking at the past, present, and future aspects of NIV. The lecture was so commendable. As Dr. CN Reddy said, we had really learned so many things. And we thought it's a simple topic, but we didn't know that so many issues are related in that. And really, you had mystified so many of our doubts. And I sincerely thank you for appreciating IAPTCB deed of contributing HFNCs to Gandhi and Nilofer. We thought they are very useful to Gandhi and Nilofer. And honestly, they are happy and using extensively. So once again, I thank you for sparing your precious time. And I'm so happy you are sitting in a golden room with golden walls, golden curtains, everything is gold, I think. Thank you. Really commendable. Thank you. And I thank all the participants for staying back for 1 hour, 20 minutes, listening with great interest. And to my surprise, despite so many hurdles tonight, the participants were more than 100 persons. Despite our PM Modi's address, and we had Pat's webinar just 1 hour before our webinar. It shows the interest of the topic and the caliber of the speaker. So I sincerely applaud you, Dr. Suresh. And I thank Dr. Pritham, who had instantaneously accepted my request to be the moderator, because 2 days ago he was the speaker on this webinar. And he had managed so well, he had managed some improperly asked questions, made them proper and asked. Thank you, Dr. Pritham, and thank my sincere wholehearted thanks to RSV. Without his presence, probably we could not have had this smooth webinars. Thank you, RSV. And my appeal to all our IAPTC members is kindly use our app. We have a separate IAPTC app, in that all these webinars are uploaded, and we have many other information in that. In future, we'll be intimating you about the app's contents. Kindly make use of them. So with these few words, I conclude this session. I sincerely thank you one and all. I thank the participants, speakers, moderator, our president, treasurer, and our RSV. Thank you one and all. Good night. Have a pleasant dinner. Stay safe. Good night. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone. Make sure you press on leave meeting before you exit. The app will run in the background otherwise. That's all from here. I'll be ending the meeting. The YouTube link is active. Anybody who would like to view it again or share it with others can go to the YouTube link and see the session again. That's all. Ending the meeting now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.